Hello, everyone, and welcome to our New Year's Eve Velocity Online service. Once a year, we take 1 week to give all of our volunteers a break from serving on a Sunday morning, and we do church with our families from our homes. We hope this is a relaxing day for you and your family, and we can't wait to see you next week in person as we kick off all of the exciting things that we are heading into as a church in 2024. Now, today's online service is going to be a little different than years past. If you stick with us, not only will you hear a relevant message and get to sing with us, you'll also have the opportunity to play some trivia, see the promo for an upcoming church event, and even have the chance to win an awesome prize. But before we kick things off, let's check out our end of year recap as we celebrate all the awesome things that God allowed us to be a part of as a church in 2023.
Velocity is special to me in a few ways. You know, we've found some new friends and a new community that we really feel like we're a part of, and I think it's special because everyone is welcome here and everyone can feel like they belong no matter what background they have or different things they have going on in their life.
And what ways Velocity is special to me is it's like a home. It really is like home. I've been to other churches and I've been not very welcomed, only because church has a tendency to be kind of daunting. And when you walk in Velocity, I immediately felt welcome. Like, wow, it's really kind of cool here. I didn't feel restricted, like with the clothing, and It just felt like, it felt home. Velocity always makes me feel at home, and they always give out the best hugs.
But this is the first church that I have really, truly grown. I see the love of God through Nate and his ministry for my children. So it's not just about me, it's about my children as well. I have grown just being in the field groups and just not being a bench warmer. You know, I don't want to just come to church and worship and leave. I want to do something and be a part of it. It's just really a good place to be. And the love that you feel here is just amazing. Just to come as you are, just they really meet you where you are. People meet you where you are the way Jesus does.
The reason I decided to get baptized is Because I know that Jesus loves me, and I'll always love him.
This week, I read an article by Forbes Health, and in the article, Sarah Davis discusses the interesting trends and statistics surrounding 2024 New Year's resolutions. Now, of all the goals that people will set, Forbes found that five specific goals were exponentially more popular than others. The fifth most common resolution was an improved diet, fourth place was losing weight, third place went to people who wanted to invest in their mental health. The second most popular was improving one's finances, but the number one resolution was improving all-around fitness, like going to the gym, making a plan and sticking to it, downloading a health app, and more. But there was another statistic in the article that was predictable because we've all heard it before and yet was so disheartening to read. And that was, of course, that of all the people who will set a goal in 2024, 65% of them won't make it to March before they fall away from their resolution. But the thing I found even more interesting was that 64% of people feel pressured to make a New Year's resolution. In other words, they would otherwise go on with their lives, but there seems to be social pressure to jump into 2024 with an improvement strategy of some kind. This means despite all the statistics squashing the idea that January 1 goal setting works, people still feel the need to run towards this goal anyway. And that reminded me of something that we've been learning as a church. Because several weeks ago, we started a series called D1, and we learned all about the first century church and a quality that the individuals in the first century church had. And that quality, the Bible tells us, was something called being devoted. Now, devoted doesn't mean that they were going to do something within 3 months and then lost resolve. No, devoted meant they were running towards something that was so important, so valuable, something that mattered so much that there was no amount of difficulty that would stop them from continuing in their devotion. And we know this because of the word that Luke used when he described their devotion. Look at how Luke describes the first century believers in Acts 2:42. It says this: "They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and sights performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and they had everything in common. They sold their property and possessions to give to anyone who had need, and every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to the number daily of those that were being saved." You see, the men and women who were following Jesus at this time were absolutely devoted. And as a result of their devotion, they grew daily and God blessed them in ways they never would have imagined. And as you may remember, the English word devoted is a translation of the Greek word proskuneo. We learn that when Luke used this word proskuneo, it was a conjunction of two words. It was a conjunction of pros, which meant going towards, and the Greek word kuneo, which meant strong or to be strong. So when you put the words pros and kuneo together, you get proskuneo, and the word means to go towards something with strong effort, despite the difficulty. Proskuneo. It means this isn't easy. It isn't simple. But no matter how challenging this may be, I'm going to continue to walk towards this goal with everything inside of me because I'm proskuneo. I'm devoted. But what would this look like? Like, in light of New Year's resolution, the reality that they don't often last, what would it look like to be truly devoted and to devote our lives to God in a new year in a way that wouldn't fade? Well, when it comes to examples of people in Scripture who were abundantly devoted, there was one person who comes to the front of my mind. And interestingly enough, the highlight of this person's story takes place right after Christmas, right after the birth of Jesus. But before we talk about this person, we're actually going to hit pause on our message and we're going to play a trivia game. And since we aren't in person, I want you to put your answers in the comment section below. We're going to play a clip from various Christmas movies and you're going to have to guess which movie it's from. But there's a twist. We're going to blur the screen so that you're going to have to rely on what you hear in the very faint image that you see. There's no prize for this one. This one's just for fun. But don't forget to stick around till the end because there is a prize to win at the end of our online service. Here goes.
Clark.
Yes, honey?
Audrey's frozen from the waist down.
That's all part of the experience, honey.
There it is.
Look, Daddy, teacher says every time a bell rings, an angel gets his wings.
That's right. Attaboy, Clark.
My family disappeared.
Run, run, Rudolph. Randolph ain't too far behind. Run, run, Rudolph. Santa's gotta make it to town.
The North Pole, of course. This is the Polar Express.
The North Pole?
I see. Hold this, please. Thank you.
Would you please tell her that you're not really Santa Claus? That there actually is no such person?
Well, I'm sorry to disagree with you, Mrs. Walker, but not only is there such a person, but here I am to prove it.
Hey, ho, ho, ho! Ah! Yeah! It's me, buddy!
Hey, immediately, my feet began to sweat as those two fluffy little bunnies with the blue button eyes stared sappily up at me.
Come down here so I can see you better.
I just hoped that Flick would...
Then he slunk to the icebox.
Slunk?
All right, guys, that was super fun, but I've kept you on the edge of your seat for too long. The person in the Bible who showed unmatched devotion to the Lord, drum roll please, was a man named Simeon. Now, to understand Simeon's story, there's a couple things we need to understand first. First, we need to know that he was not a young guy. He was actually an older guy who had lived a full life. But there's one thing Simeon wanted before he died. And to understand that, we have to know that for his whole life, he was a devoted reader of the Hebrew Bible, what we call the Old Testament. He went to temple and he heard the Bible read aloud. He knew the Hebrew scripture and the promises within. Simeon knew that all of the writers of the Bible spoke of a future Savior who would come to rescue people from the evil of this world and from their own sin and mistakes. And like many people in Simeon's day, he hoped that he would be able to see the Savior, the Messiah, during his lifetime. Not only because he wanted to witness it, because also he longed for God to restore the brokenness that he saw on earth. And with this in mind, I want you to look at what the Bible says in Luke 2, verse 25. It says, "Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon, who was a righteous and devout man. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts." Now, there's so much here that I don't want us to miss. Luke tells us that Simeon was living in Jerusalem and that he was waiting for the consolation of Israel. Now, consolation literally means comfort received after a loss. Think consolation prize. You see, Israel was God's chosen people, the family on earth through which the Messiah would be born. But throughout Israel's history, they made so many mistakes. And at this time in the story, Israel was living under the oppression of Rome, and the Jewish people were desperate for a savior. And Simeon was no exception. But the Bible tells us that not only was he hoping for a Savior, but the Holy Spirit actually told him he wouldn't die before seeing the Christ. And so Simeon, with all of this hope in his heart and all the promises from God that he saw in the Bible, he went to the temple. And who else was heading to the temple at this exact moment? Well, to see this, look at what the Bible tells us in verse 22. It says, "When the time came for the purification rites required by the law of Moses, Joseph and Mary took him," meaning Jesus, "to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it was written In the law of the Lord, every firstborn male is to be consecrated to the Lord, and to offer sacrifices in keeping with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of doves and two young pigeons. So get this, at the same time Simeon is being led by the Spirit of God to go to the temple, Mary and Joseph are heading to the temple, not because the Spirit of God whispered in their ear to do so, but because they were faithfully following the law of Moses. And I think this moment is incredible. I mean, you have one man devoted to heading to the temple because he's obedient to God's leading, and then you have Mary and Joseph, this couple, heading to the temple with Jesus out of obedience to what's commanded in Scripture. And you know what? In light of all the things we can run to and devote ourselves to in the new year, I think it's notable to pause here and recognize the value and importance of the things that these individuals ran to with unwavering resolve. But I want you to see what these two groups do when they meet. Look at what the Bible says in verse 27. When the parents brought the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel." The child's father and mother marveled at what was said about him. Now, there's so much that can be said about Simeon, and quite frankly, there's a sermon series worth of things that we could unpack in this small section of Scripture. But for today, I simply want to focus on one thing: Simeon's hope and unwavering dedication. Of all the things Simeon could have spent his days building towards, running at, hoping and investing in, we see that his devotion was first and foremost to the Lord. He knew the Scripture because he was devoted to it. He recognized God's voice when he spoke because Simeon had had trained ear after years of being guided by God's Spirit. And he was so devoted to the coming Messiah that once Jesus arrived, Simeon knew that his life on earth would never be more fulfilled than it was in this moment. He was ready for his life on this side of heaven to be over because nothing would be better or sweeter or more worthwhile than this moment where he held in his arms Emmanuel, God with us. And honestly, church, I think that we can glean a lot from that. Because the reality is, of all the things that we can run to this year, of all the things that we could invest our time in, of all the things that we could say, I'm going to do this, I'm going to achieve that, this is the year where I finally fill in the blank. I think if we could pause from those things, and I'm not saying we don't invest in ourselves. I'm not saying we don't care for ourselves physically or financially. But if we could just take this year and instead of making a resolution that we might not even make it till March before we fall off, but instead if we could take this year and live more like Simeon, to know that of all the things in the world that we could run towards and devote ourselves to, and of all the things in life that we could achieve and have, there's nothing more valuable, there's nothing more impactful, there's nothing more life-changing than just to know Christ. What would it look like this year to be absolutely devoted to Jesus? Maybe this is the year that we pick up the Bible for the first time in a long time and we truly read it. I've been there. I've been in seasons of my life where I go to church and I kind of go through the motions of Christianity, but I'm not reading the Word for myself. And for some of us, this is going to be the year where we start reading the Bible for ourselves and we start reading the Bible with our families. For others of us, we're super committed to coming to church, but we look around and we don't even really know anyone. And maybe this is the year where we dive fully invested into community. We join a fuel group. We invite people into our homes and we get to know the people that we come to church with day in and day out. I don't know what this is going to look like for you, but I want you to consider this question today. What would it look like, instead of setting a New Year's resolution for fitness and finances and future, what would it look like to say, God, this year, I want to devote myself to you? And if you're someone who wants to do that, even if you don't know what that looks like yet, if you're someone who wants to say, God, I want to devote myself to you this year, I encourage you to come next week when we're back in person. Because Scott is preparing a brand new sermon series that was birthed out of the D1 series, and we are going to see through Scripture, real life examples of people, what it really looks like to fully devote our lives to God. You won't want to miss it. But for now, let me pray for us. And after I pray, we're going to do something fun. Dear God, thank you so much for everyone who tuned in online today. God, I thank you for the families and the people that come to Velocity Church and call this church their home. God, in this new year, give us wisdom and clarity about the things that you want us to devote ourselves to. The things we tend to chase after at the beginning of the year, they're not bad. Some of them are actually really, really good things to consider. But God, there's something that's more important than all of these. So help us to really have a life devoted to you. God, I thank you for our church. I pray that you will bless all of the things that we do as a church in this new year. And I pray that we will follow you as you lead us to all of the ways that you're going to help us make an impact in 2024. We thank you for who you are. And ultimately, Lord, we thank you for Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Hey guys, before we get to the end of our video and we give away an awesome prize, we're going to sing one song together as a church during this online service. And this is a song that Eric picked because he believed it was such a good representation of Simeon at the temple and what he must have felt like when he held Jesus in his arms and what we will feel like when we live a life devoted to Jesus. So sing this with us.
This king, a servant to be, how fittingly humble his birth. This child, a baby so small, savior of all of the earth. How beautiful this night, it's the glorious birth of Christ. Child of glory, infant, holy, humbly, I approach your throne. Peaceful babe and awesome Savior, I will live for you alone. This Lord, parents so poor, his inheritance glory above. This babe, the earth's only hope, grown up to show us true love. How beautiful this night, it's the glorious birth of Christ. Child of glory, infant, holy, humbly, I approach your throne. Peaceful babe and awesome Savior, I will live for you. Lord, I love you. Lord, I need you. I will live for you alone. I love you. Lord, I need you. I will live for you alone. Lord, I love you. Lord, I need you. I will live for you alone. Lord, I love you. Lord, I need you. I will live for you alone. A child of glory, infant, holy, humbly, I approach your throne. Peaceful babe and awesome Savior, I will live for you alone.
We'll be right back.
All right, guys, you made it to the end of the video. And like we said, we're going to give out an awesome prize to one family or couple or individual who's watching right now. What's going to happen is we're going to put a number up on the screen. And the first person to call this number is going to be able to go to lunch with Scott and Vanessa next week after church. Right after church, you're going to go. They're going to buy you an awesome meal. You're going to get to spend some time with them. And it's going to be an absolute blast. So get out your phones and dial this, 216-904-2745. Again, that's 216-904-2745. Whoever calls that number first is going to get to go to lunch with Scott and V, and you're going to have an absolute blast. For the rest of you, we hope you had an amazing Christmas. We hope you have a happy new year, and we'll see you next week.